So, a very good evening to one and all gathered here. It gives me immense pleasure to welcome you all to the weekly webinar series conducted by IEEE Malabar subsection in association with IEEE Malabar Hub on the 72th webinar on the topic AI, the game changer in computational molecular biology. Today's session will be jointly conducted by Dr. Jayaraj PB, Assistant Professor of CS from NIT Calicut, and Mrs. Jisna VA, Senior Research Scholar of CS at NIT Calicut. We are honored to have with us Dr. Jayaraj PB, who is a PhD holder in computer science from NIT Calicut and is also currently working as Assistant Professor in the Department of Computer Science Engineering at the same. His research interests include AI, high performance computing, and health informatics. As a part of his thesis, he had applied machine learning for simplifying the drug discovery pipeline. He is the founder of AI Club of NIT Calicut, which includes projects like organ contouring in CT images using UNETS, CT image synthesis from MR image using GANS, detection of cervical cancer disease using object detection algorithm, and much more. Sir, I wholeheartedly welcome you to this session. Joining Dr. Jayaraj PB, we have Mrs. Jisna VA, who is a senior research scholar in the Department of Computer Science and Engineering at NIT Calicut. She completed her BTech and MTech under Calicut University and has also served as an assistant professor at Jyothi Engineering College, Thrissur. Her research interests are in computational biology, particularly protein structure prediction methods and protein structure assignments. She has presented papers at conferences and published articles in prestigious journals. A very warm welcome to you, ma'am. Now, I call upon Dr. Jayaraj PB to start the session. Over to you, sir.
Yeah, can you hear me, Priyanka?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so my slides are visible, right?
Yes, sir.
Good evening all. First of all, I thank Malabar IEEE section for giving this opportunity to us. So I'll begin, okay. So AI, so people are nowadays calling AI as the new electricity. Why? Because electricity has transferred countless industries earlier, right? Yeah, so now AI will bring equally all these revolutions in industries like healthcare, manufacturing and transportation. Yeah, so when you see, these are my outline. We together are delivering this talk. So I'll be starting with AI introduction, giving introduction on AI, the history of AI, then machine learning, the subsection of AI called machine learning I'll be introducing. Then one of the supervised learning technique called random forest, which I applied in drug discovery, I'll be showing you in a glance. Then I slightly introduce ANN, artificial neural network, then convolutional neural network and deep learning also. And finally, I'll transfer to Jisna. She'll be telling how this deep learning can be applied for this computational molecular biology. Mainly we apply this for a protein secondary assignment. Let me begin with this remarks from Alan Turing. Okay, all of us are aware of Alan Turing. His Turing test is very much famous, right? The computability test, right? It's very much famous. He said, we can only see a short distance ahead, but we can see a plenty there that needs to be done. So as he said, right, in fact, AI was coined in 1950s and we are in 2021. So we are going ahead in 70 plus years, but still a lot more to be done. Okay, so we are all to achieve that. Okay, I'll just define what is artificial intelligence, just to begin. Okay, so John McCarthy, one of the famous scientists who coined, in fact, the subfield artificial intelligence. He said artificial intelligence is the science and engineering of making intelligent machines, especially intelligent computer programs. The other scientist, the eminent scientist, Rich and Knight, They define AI as the study of how to make computers do things at which at the moment people are better. These are the short history of AI, the major milestones that had happened in the discovery of AI. So in 1943, McCulloch and Pitts, formed a first neural network. Then Minsky in 1951, he built a neural net computer. And in 1956, the name, in fact, subfield AI was coined in this particular conference called Dartmouth Conference. So four people, four eminent scientists, McCarthy, Minsky, Newell, Simon, all the, they met together, and they proposed they gave a proposal for this artificial intelligence. Hence, the subfield was coined, the artificial intelligence. In 1952, McCarthy again found in 58, McCarthy found Lisp language, so Lisp processing language, which was used in the initial days of artificial intelligence. 1957, Perceptron was formed by the Frank Rosenblatt. And in 1965, multi-level Perceptron was also invented. Later than 1986, again a return to a neural network has witnessed after a gap of 20 years, back propagation algorithm was invented. Then in 1989, convolutional neural network was found. Even though it was found, we could not utilize it properly. Why? Because they require a lot of compute power. In 1990s, this compute power was not available with us. And in 1991, people invented recurrent neural networks. 1997, Elastium Law, it's another improvement of RNN. Then 2007, all these neural networks, they require huge compute power. So in 2007, a company called NVIDIA, they invented GPUs and a parallel framework called CUDA, Compute Unified Device Architecture, was invented. So after the invention of GPUs and parallel programming, CUDA for parallel programming, the forming neural networks was much easier. In 2012, Adam optimizer, which was used in gradient descent algorithm, which was much useful. Then 2014, Ian Goodfellow, he invented GAN network, generative adversarial network, which people are using for synthesizing images, etc. Even we can apply it for things like protein docking, protein structure prediction, etc. In 2016, Pascal GPU, these architecture were found. Yeah, initially when GPUs were found, right, initially they were with Kepler architecture, then Maxwell came, after which Pascal came. Pascal in 2016, we witnessed a new technology called unified memory. Both the GPUs and CPUs can access each of their memories without transferring the contents. Yeah. And after Pascal, Turing came, then Volta, then after which Ampere, which in last year, Ampere, they released Ampere. So the Ampere GPUs, when you see the Ampere GPU, it has 7,000, nearly 7,000 CUDA cores in it. And they support both 40 GB and 100 GB of graphics RAM. And their memory bandwidth comes nearly 1.6 terabytes per second. Then they altogether may produce 19.5 teraflops of single precision compute power. So because of these GPUs, now the new after 2016, after Pascal came, this neural networks, this neural network computing has gone into a different realm. So in 2017, transformers were invented, which was an improvement over LSTM in the same RNN category. As I can say that with the invention of, with the availability of the GPU compute power and other advancements in the computation, just things like back propagation and gradient descent, etc. We can program the neural network easily for meeting our requirements. You can easily solve your problems. Yeah. So I told you the birthplace of artificial neural network was, it is at Dartmouth workshop. Which was happened in 1956. Four people met together and they gave a proposal. Finally, this subfield named artificial intelligence was coined. What are the main goals of AI? To make computers more useful by letting them take over dangerous or tedious tasks from human and understanding the principle of human intelligence. When you see the areas of AI and some other dependent areas, so you can see the main area which I am touching today is machine learning, which are called modern AI. There are in traditional AI, people describe knowledge representation, logic, and the search techniques, etc. But today I am only touching upon this modern AI technique called machine learning. Again, it's subfield deep learning we will be touching. Yeah, so to begin with, I'm staking a drug discovery application, which is part of protein computational molecular modeling. So yeah, let me explain you what is virtual screening. So screening is just a computational technique used to reduce the search space from which this lead, this actual drug molecule is found. Yeah. So as you are aware, for any disease, there will be a cross protein target, and correspondingly, we'll have to find a new ligand molecule which act as a drug for this, which will come and bind with this target molecule and they transduct energy, and finally, we get a cure. In fact, the 3D dimensional structure of the cross molecule will be changing, their functionality will be changing. Yeah. So this drug discovery start from the scratch. In fact, we'll have a large search space from the combinatorial chemistry. So billions of molecules, especially, we have already on 10 raised to 60 molecules is possible, but yeah, we'll take billions of molecules, 10 raised to 7, from which we'll have to reduce down. So we'll have to screen molecules and we'll have to come up with some lead molecules. This job is done with the help of computer so that we can avoid a lot of wet lab experimentation, because wet lab experimentation is laborious and time consuming and costly also. So that's why we are looking for the help from the computer. Yeah. So these molecules, in fact, these wet lab experimentation molecules will be available in the form of bioassays. Seeing the bioassay, we can easily convert it into some descriptors. So these molecules are available in the form of SDF file, structured data file, which we can convert this into the features like this. Some of the features are pH value, molecular weight, blood-brain barrier, etc. So likewise, 179 descriptors we utilize for doing this work. So a molecule is represented as a vector in a multidimensional space, 179. There are 179 descriptors utilized for this. Yeah, so we can create a training set like this from the bioassays received from some of the repositories, and utilizing this training set, we can model it. We can train a random forest, which is a supervised technique, which is an ensemble technique comprising of a lot of decision trees. So we can train this using which a model. We can create a model. This model, we can submit our unknown test molecules. You can pass it to this so that they will classify it as either active or inactive. Basically, they are checking for the activity of the given ligand with the target. So in this direction, we have published a paper, and I think interested people can search this. Yeah, so I was talking about random forest, which is supervised learning technique under machine learning, a classification. Right, so this artificial neural network, ANN, is another kind of supervised learning. Yeah, I told you about gradient descent. So this, the backward propagation is very much important. We are highly using it in the gradient descent algorithm to model a neural network, which has in the input neuron, input layer, hidden layer, and output layer. So all these supervised learning techniques, the main difficulty we are facing is we need to do some feature extraction. So after extracting features, seeing the features only, these the models were created. So that was the main difficulty. But nowadays, as the time goes on, actually deep learning was invented. The main benefit of this deep learning is they have an additional section which will extract these details. So they have feature engineering with them itself. So we need not extract this these features by our own. So deep learning will do, they will themselves do that. So, but the other side of deep learning is they need training sets, the training data. So, but in this digital era, so from internet itself, there are plenty of details are available. So it is not a big thing now. Yeah, so I told you all these deep learning neural networks, they require a lot of compute power. So with the availability of GPUs and the CUDA parallel programming, I think most of our frameworks, TensorFlow and PyTorch, they are utilizing it. With the help of them, we can easily do this. So yeah, that's what AI is acting as a game changer now in many fields. Computer vision, you can see object detection, which is heavily applied in self-driving cars, robotics, etc., and recommender system. And similarly, reinforcement learning is heavily applied in robots. Also, the stock trading robots, etc. And similarly, in self-driving car, the decision to if we meet with an object, whether to divert into left or right, such decision making things are done with the help of reinforcement learning algorithm. Yeah, I told you this deep learning as a convolutional neural network has an additional layer called convolution. So they use filters using which they will be striding, means they will be scanning through the entire the data space, and they convolve certain information which is called free feature map. Seeing this feature map, this convolution create the feature. It has feature engineering. They create features. So these feature maps, the convolved image contains these features. So utilizing that, this kind of convolution neural network will do the classification. This is the general pipeline. So input will be given into convolution, then pooling. Again, a convolution, a set of convolution and pooling will be happening. Finally, this will be given into a fully connected layer, which will contain dense layers. And finally, so the act of classification or prediction will be happening. Yeah, so this is my closing remark. Again, I'm pointing certainly notes from Alan Turing. So Alan Turing said this, because we are aware that he was a famous scholar, but he was a runner too. So I have such a stressful job that the only way I can get it out of my mind is by running hard. But when you see from the picture itself, this finishing line is not known. Yeah, it is applicable to our the case of AI experimentation also. So we don't know where the finishing line is, or that we'll have to do again and again, and we'll have to invent something. Okay, so that's it from my side. And my research student, Jisita, will be explaining the rest of the portions. I think she will be explaining how deep learning can be applied for this secondary structure assignment. Okay, so I told you because with a group of passionate students, we have formed a club, tech club in NIT Calicut called AI Club. So we are doing a lot of work, as Priyanka initially, as she was telling. So we are doing a lot of healthcare works, radiotherapy, some of the works which will help in radiotherapy workflow, like auto contouring, and then synthesizing FPCBCT, FPCT, etc. from MRI images. And we are also applying AI in dentistry, and in protein structure prediction and protein docking. A lot many works we are doing in this club. So that's it from my side, and I'll hand over the control to now just now. One second, I'll stop sharing now. Yeah, your doubts you can ask.
Hello.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you. Then we will start. Good afternoon, all. Myself, Jasna. I'm a research scholar from NIT Calicut, from the Department of Computer Science and Engineering. I'm doing my research under the guidance of Dr. Jairaj PB. Okay. Today we will talk about computational molecular biology, how deep learning is applied in computational molecular biology. Here's the outline of my presentation. So molecular biology, I think most of you know that molecular biology means it deals with the composition, structure, and interactions of biological components, such as nucleic acids, proteins, etc. Computational molecular biology, what it does is, computational molecular biology people, they apply computational methods on large collection of biological data to organize this data, to analyze this data, to make new predictions from this data. So today I am going to talk about particularly about proteins. Okay, so proteins, these proteins are, we know that they are large biomolecules that regulates and executes nearly every biological function. And we know that they are essential to our life and for all organisms. They are required for the structure, function, and regulation of bodies, tissues, and organs. And whole of this variety of functions, the variety of function that the proteins does is due to their structural diversity, which means that proteins are in different structures. And these structures makes them, this variety of structures makes them to do variety of functions. Like we have proteins that will that access transport systems, that access storage systems, that are enzymes. There are proteins that access antibodies. These antibodies bind to specific foreign particles and help protect our body. So I will tell you some basics about proteins, since we are talking about an interdisciplinary area that combines proteins, that combines biology plus computer science. So I will tell you some basics about proteins. Hello.
Yes, ma'am. Continue.
Yes, yes. Okay. Then only you will be able to understand the remaining slides. Okay. Now, proteins are made up of amino acids. You may be knowing that. These proteins, which are made from the sequence of amino acids, this sequence of amino acids actually uniquely determines the structure of a protein. Why the structure of a protein is important? The structure of a protein is important because it is the structure that defines the function of a protein, or it is the structure that tells us what function the protein is going to do. So structure is important in case of proteins. And to my knowledge, most of the research in the area of proteins revolves around this structure, protein structures. We have experimental methods for protein structure determination, like X-ray crystallography, NMR spectroscopy, and recently electron microscopy, etc. The problem with these methods are they are, even though they are reliable methods, they are costly and laborious and time consuming. In that figure, you can see a protein sequence. These protein sequences will appear as a chain of beads. These beads represent the amino acids. These amino acids are connected by some bonds called peptide bonds, and we will have a protein chain. So this protein chain will not remain as such. This protein chain folds. It folds and folds. That is what the protein, that is what the term protein folding. This chain will fold until it reaches a stable state. It gets a stable structure. So when talking about protein structure, one must know the different levels of protein structures. So first one is the primary structure. I will tell this through figures. The first level is the primary structure, which is simply the chain of amino acids. These amino acids are connected by peptide bonds. It is like a chain. And as long as this chain is formed, this chain immediately folds and forms secondary structures. So these secondary structures are formed from amino acids, adjacent amino acids. Adjacent amino acids will interact and may form bonds between each other and will result in some structures, some local substructures. And why we are calling this as secondary structures is that we will see some regular structures, regular substructures here. In that figure, you can see alpha helix, a coil type of structure that is called alpha helix, and beta sheets. So these are some regular type of substructures that we can see in almost all proteins. Even in a single protein, you can see this these substructures frequently. So these forms the regular, these are formed from the adjacent amino acids. These are the regular substructures. These are called secondary substructures, secondary structures. Of course, we have irregular structures also. Sometimes the adjacent amino acids may not form a regular form shape like this. So irregular shapes are also there. We will call it as loops. This is the secondary structure. And below figure, you can see tertiary structure. Tertiary, we will call tertiary as the overall structure of a protein. So immediately after forming the secondary structure, this folding process, the folding of the protein chain continues. It continues until a stable state is reached. So while this folding process progresses, we can see here that a bond is formed between faraway amino acids. So far in secondary structure, we talked about bond formation between adjacent amino acids. Now the bonds are formed between, as this folding process progresses, the bonds are formed between faraway amino acids. So here in this figure, you can see a bond is formed between an alpha helix and a beta sheet. And if these kinds of bonds, if these bonds are strong enough to hold the structure, then that bond will remain there. Similarly, this folding process continues and mini bonds are formed between faraway amino acids and all until this folding process stops until it reaches a stable state. We can say it completely stops. After it reaches a stable state, there won't be any much serious changes to the structure. So that is the tertiary structure. This is the overall structure of a protein. So protein structure prediction means this structure prediction, people have to predict the structure of a protein from the primary sequence. And then we have the quaternary structures. Now, so far we talked about a single polypeptide chain. Some proteins are made from multiple polypeptide chains. So each of these polypeptide chains may have their own independent structure, and when they form a complex, it becomes a quaternary structure. So some proteins also exhibit this complex structure, that is the quaternary structure. Now, why this protein folds? The entire folding or the entire flexibility of this protein chain is due to the angles in amino acids. This results in the flexibility of that protein chain. So these amino acids are made from atoms, made using group of atoms. We have 20 naturally occurring amino acids, and these amino acids are represented by a group of atoms. So obviously there must be bonds and bond angles between these atoms. In this figure, you can see there are torsional angles also. So in that figure, you can see in the middle, you can see an alpha carbon named atom. And to the below and upper portion, you can see the atoms are arranged in the form of a plane. And in the above portion also, you can see two planes. And the angle between those two planes are called the torsional angles. Normally, we will say torsional or dihedral angles means angle between planes. Here also, in the case of amino acids also, you can see angles between these planes. So the whole flexibility, there is a lot to say about here, but I'm briefly saying that the whole flexibility of the protein chain is due to the flexibility of these angles, Okay, now I'll tell you one more term, sequence structure gap. In the case of proteins, as the name implies, there is a large gap exists between protein sequences and protein structures. This graph shows that sequence structure gap. The red bar shows the protein sequences and the blue bar shows the statistics of protein structures. So we have a lot of protein sequences in protein repositories, billions of protein sequences, but we don't have enough protein structures because we have already seen that the structure determination methods, experimental methods are laborious. They are time consuming and costly. So we are having around 2 lakh protein structures so far till 2021. We have around 2 lakh protein structures in protein structure repositories. The main repository for protein structure is PDB, Protein Data Bank. But we have billions of protein sequences. So there is a wide gap between these protein sequences and protein structures. This we will call it a sequence structure gap. So the main aim of a computational biologist who is working in proteins is to reduce this gap, to bridge this gap. That is why we are going for alternate or computational methods for protein structure prediction. So this is one of the hardest challenges in this computational molecular biology. Okay, now we will see some of the domains that use deep learning methods in deep learning methods in the area of proteins. And then we will see we will take one such area and we will see how deep learning is applied in that particular area. Now, deep learning methods are widely applied in one-dimensional protein structure annotation, which means that you can use deep learning methods to predict the secondary structure of a protein or to predict the torsional angle of an amino acid from a protein sequence. So you can see, I will expand that in the second point. So in the second point, you can see protein structure prediction. These deep learning methods are widely used for protein secondary structure prediction. Secondary structure prediction means given an amino acid sequence or a protein sequence, your deep learning model has to predict the secondary structure of that amino acid sequence. An example is shown there. The primary sequence is given. Primary sequence is represented as a string of letters. Now, you have amino acids. These primary sequences, these protein sequences are made of amino acids. We have 20 naturally occurring standard amino acids. So these 20 amino acids are represented by using 20 letters from English alphabet. So for each amino acid, we have a letter from English alphabet. So this primary is a string of these amino acids, a string of these letters. And what this deep learning model that we will, these models will do is that these models are trained with a lot of primary and secondary sequences. And upon giving a primary sequence, the model must say its secondary sequence, secondary structure. the secondary structures are shown below. You can see the secondary structure sequence also here. So it is a kind of sequence to sequence mapping. From its primary sequence, the model has to predict the secondary sequence. So this secondary structure prediction in turn reduces the complexity of our bigger problem. Our big problem is the protein tertiary structure prediction. In protein tertiary structure prediction, what we have to do is that we have to predict the coordinates of an amino acid from a given amino acid sequence, or we have to predict the structure from an amino acid sequence. Structure means this structure, it is a structure in space. So in this protein structures, when you represent this structure, each of the amino acids have a coordinate, x, y, z coordinates. So this protein structure prediction methods, they have to predict the x, y, z coordinates of each of the amino acids in our sequence. So that is a bit difficult task for deep learning models, not for any model, any kind of models. That is a big problem here. In the previous case, we have a sequence to sequence mapping only. Here we have to predict this sequence to coordinates. And almost a majority of subdomains in this protein revolves around this protein structure prediction, or they try to support this protein structure prediction people in some indirectly or indirect methods. And next area where we apply deep learning methods are protein function prediction. Here we are directly, we are not going for structure. This model will learn the characteristics or features from the protein sequences, and the model will predict the function of a given protein sequence. So that is one area. And another areas include protein design, protein-protein interaction, structure assignments, etc. This protein design is a kind of reverse engineering. Here you are going to design amino acid sequence, which means that suppose you know that you need a protein structure of this, we need a protein, this type of protein structure to fight with an external virus, to external particle. Then you're going back, you are doing a kind of reverse engineering and finding out which amino acid sequence will lead to this kind of structure. So that is what protein design. For this, these areas also protein deep learning methods are widely deployed. Another main area is protein-protein interaction. Protein-protein interaction prediction means we are predicting whether two proteins will interact, whether two proteins will bind. So here, in this area, the people will determine if two proteins are interacting physically in a cell using their amino acid sequences. So this is this is highly desirable for this understanding of cellular process, and these are used for identifying the drug targets. And another sub area in the same area, in the same protein interaction area, is interface prediction. Interface prediction is nothing. You have to predict, or your model have to predict, in which interface or in which area these proteins are going to predict, the interface in which they are going to bind or interact. That is one of the widely known area that undergoes research. And another area is protein structure assignments. I will explain this area in the later slides because we are taking this as a study, case study. And then you have other areas like protein sequence alignments, protein quality assessment, etc. Protein quality assessment means suppose you have a protein structure, your model predicted a protein structure. So you want to assess the quality of that model, quality of that structure. So for that, deep learning methods are widely deployed to assess the quality of the predicted structures. Now we will see specifically how this deep learning model, we have applied deep learning models in this protein structure assignments. I will briefly go through this. I am not going much details on this deep learning part. So protein structure assignments, what is this protein structure assignments? You can see that figure. In that figure, you have protein coordinates. Usually when an experimental people determine the structure of a protein, they will note down the protein coordinates. They will use some X-ray crystallography or NMR spectroscopy technique, and they have the protein coordinates with us. Now they have to deposit these protein coordinates in some repositories. These details of the proteins in some repositories, then only it will be available for public. So while depositing these structures, they have to provide all details of these structures, including its sequence, its secondary structure, and other details, the species it belongs to, and so many other details. So protein secondary structure assignments, what it means that this area, what the people do is that they will assign a secondary structure to the tertiary coordinates, or they will tell the secondary structure of the protein tertiary coordinates. So they are given with a sequence of protein coordinates, and they have to tell the secondary structure that the protein takes. So initially, this is done by visual inspections. Initially, these are done manually by visual inspection by these experimental people itself. And they will check these coordinates, and they will say that these coordinates will be forming a helix structure, or these coordinates will be forming a sheet structure, etc. And they will be marking it accordingly, and they are publishing their results. Now, discrepancies are there between the scientists. And later, this process gets automated. So even after automating this process, the people are using geometric calculations and hydrogen bonding information for assigning the secondary structure to the 3D coordinates. And we found that this is an exceptional area in computational biology, which is not revolutionized by the data explosion and AI techniques. And we also found that the data sets available are not suitable for deep learning purposes. So we tried to apply deep learning to this protein structure assignment area. So what we did is that instead of applying this method, deep learning methods, to entire protein, we tried to apply this on protein fragments. Protein fragments means protein pieces. What we did is that we cut the protein into pieces according to the secondary structure. So we cut them into pieces according to the helix, sheet, or coil, or loop structure. I will show the figure here. This is the overall workflow. First we downloaded the protein structures from the repository, and PDB is the widely used repository available to public. It contains the structures of all proteins that is determined so far. And after downloading the structures, we cut this protein structures into fragments according to the secondary structure. Now we have the fragments in helix category, sheet category, coil category. And then we did some pre-processing. Pre-processing means it is not feature extraction. It is a kind of we have different length fragments with us. So we will make all these fragments into same length for our smooth learning of our model. So that kind of thing is in pre-processing stage. You can see unwanted, we remove unwanted sequences, etc. And shuffling and all. Feature scaling means we scale the values of coordinates into a particular range, say -1 to 1, for the smooth learning of our model. So we did some pre-processing on these fragments, and then we gave these fragments to a deep learning model, or we trained a deep learning model with these fragments. And the model, upon testing, the model will predict whether each of the fragment belongs to a helix, sheet, or coil. So this is the work. This is the overall workflow. And these are the fragment library statistics. We have used CUDA programs for cutting this protein, because we have large number of protein structures and large number of fragments. So we use CUDA program and the GPU servers from our college for cutting these proteins into fragments. These are the fragment library statistics. Then now we have the fragments with us. Then we applied a deep learning model. So at this stage also, you must be having some idea. Before applying a deep learning model to a computational problem or to a computational biology problem, you must be having some idea about the data you have with us, you have with you. So here we have coordinates. So here our problem is that we have to assign secondary structure to 3D coordinates. And we know that the secondary structures are formed from adjacent amino acids. These adjacent amino acids are forming a particular regular secondary structure. So we need a deep learning model that leverages this adjacency or this spatial relationship. And for that, we choose CNN, convolutional neural network. So you must be having some knowledge about the other deep learning models like LSTM. If you want to keep, if you want to memorize the things, then you have to go for LSTM models. If you have a kind of time series prediction, then you have to go for LSTM models. So you must be having some idea about what the deep learning models do also. So here we applied CNN model, convolutional neural network model, for our data, for our input. So this is the CNN model summary. This is nothing. This is a basic, very simple CNN model. This is not a complicated one. Here in a basic CNN model, you have convolutions and convolutions. The main idea behind CNN is the convolution operation. So you have to move a convolution window over your input, and this window will capture features from your input. So in this figure, you can see C1, C2, C4, C5, etc. This convolution and max pooling operations. The convolution and max pooling operation, what it does is it extracts features from the input. So you don't need to extract feature from your own and to give it separately for your model. Upon giving the input or the coordinates, this model will extract features from the coordinate. this feature extraction is done by this convolution and max pooling part. So CNN has two parts. If you are using it for classification, it will do feature extraction first, then it will do classification. So here you can see that FC layers, fully connected layers, these fully connected layers will do the classification part. After studying these features, this CNN part, this classification part, what it does is it tries to classify each of this fragment to one of the three classes. So we have feature extraction and classification here. This is what our model does. And these are the accuracy plots and loss plots. So from this accuracy and loss plots, it is clear that the loss is decreasing smoothly and accuracy is increasing. So the model is learning. It is a good curve that represents the model is learning. And here we compared our results with some of the gold standards in this area. DLFS is our proposed method. And DSSP and STRIDE, these are the gold standards in this area. So we compared our results with these gold standards and we got a pretty good results. And here, since we applied this method to protein fragments, we also tested its applicability to small full-length proteins also. So that also we did, and these are the results. And these are the visualization of our results. So for this protein, these kind of molecules, you can use PyMOL or Chimera tool or OSMOL tool for visualization. Here we have used Chimera tool for visualizing these kind of molecules. And we have published this. If you want to refer more, you can see this also. So what we have done is, and now we discovered some of the subdomains in the protein. So I'm going to my conclusion. So here we discovered some of the subdomains where we have applied deep learning techniques. And then we took one such subdomain, that is protein secondary structure assignment. And we have seen that how a simple CNN model is applied in this area. Why we choose CNN model is that CNNs are able to capture the spatial relationship between the coordinates, and we here, we need to exploit some kind of spatial dependency, adjacency property here. So we exploit CNNs and we got pretty good results there, and we can extend this to full length proteins. Now we are sure that this will work. So what I want to say is that those researchers or those students who are having some basics in biology plus some knowledge in computing, they can contribute to these kind of areas. Okay, these are my references. Thank you. Any questions?
Thank you, ma'am, for this informative session. So attendees, if you have any queries related to this topic, you can either write it down on the chat box, or it will be read out, or you can directly ask the sir and ma'am about. Anyone? Sir, if you could share your email ID in the chat box, it would be helpful for the participants to reach out to you in future if there is any doubt. Thank you, sir.